Dr. Bill Adams here. This is No Spin Live, and do we have a show for you today? We're going to talk about the FDA states an upcoming breast implant hearing. The most dangerous plastic surgery procedure, or is it? And then vaginal rejuvenation, what people are afraid to ask. And we've got some great plastic surgeons here to share their insights. We got Dr. Jason Posner from Boca Raton, Florida, Dr. Anup Patel from Orlando, Florida, and Dr. Mark Epstein from Long Island near the Big Apple. How you guys doing?
Doing great.
This is the 50th episode of No Spin Live.
That's right.
Unbelievable. We're gonna have a big party here after, and we're gonna fly you guys down. So,
All right.
Well, we got some great topics, so let's get into it. This first one is announcement by the FDA that they plan to have a hearing to discuss breast implant safety in 2019. Jason, lead us off on this one.
Oh, I don't know. This article that was published in the Annals of Surgery, not even a plastic surgery journal, a general surgery journal. And this is a response to this article, which reviewed some of the data from both Mentor and Allergan, which was looking at some autoimmune and other diseases, which may or may not be associated with breast implants. So, I mean, we're all scientists here, so we're going to look at this pretty critically. This was an article that was rejected from all the plastic surgery journals because it wasn't really a good plastic surgery article. Nevertheless, it got picked up and it got published, and it reviewed this data, which was crazy because most of the data, at least from one of the companies, was all patient self-reporting of problems that they may have had, while the other company was doctor-diagnosed diseases. And the actual data that's come up with is completely to two ends because it makes no sense and you can't really look at it and critically look at the data. So it really doesn't prove either way whether there's anything associated or any of these autoimmune diseases that are associated with, you know, any of, with breast implants. We've kind of looked at this and said that this particular article doesn't really have a lot of merit. You know, however, the FDA did respond and also said this article doesn't have a lot of merit. But the FDA has been looking into this, and one of the things that's planned for 2019 is the FDA is going to have a hearing to really examine this, you know, situation further.
Yeah, and you know, this is something that I'm not sure, you know, the article that a lot of people have been criticizing came out around the time of this, but the FDA, you know, has been meeting with different groups, a lot of the women's groups that we've talked about that have some concerns. So I think that this FDA hearing will be, you know, certainly not just about this article, just about the safety of breast implants. What did you think about this, Anup?
I agree with what Jason has said. I think they pulled two studies, they piled up two studies to try to get a lot of numbers, but you can't do that. That's taking apples and oranges and mixing them up. And they've construed all of this data and put it out to the public forefront that has now started to scare patients. And we've been through this as we talked about in the 90s, and there's been moratoriums on silicone implants. But the problem is there's a reason why this study has been rejected from all of the eminent journals in plastic surgery. It's put out in a general surgery magazine, which is where it's not going to do it any justice. It should be in our plastic surgery journal. But what's good about this is that it highlights that bad sciences has been brought to the forefront. The FDA has sort of squashed this as a good study and is showing that the public that we have to have better data to make conclusive evidence-based decisions for the public.
You know, Mark, can you comment specifically on, you know, this meeting that the FDA announced for 2019? Do you have a feeling for what the FDA will want to have discussed at that meeting?
I think the FDA is unpredictable, but what scares me here is, you know, I once saw in a Holocaust memorial statue, it said, for those who don't learn from history, you're doomed to live it again and again. And Jason alluded to that. You know, way back when, before social media and all that, you had a group of women in Huntington Beach, California, who had some rheumatologic issues, and they were blaming their implants. Then it hit Connie Chung and Jenny Jones and all that. So now you have some people who are complaining, and now it's hitting social media and it's getting more fire. Last time at the FDA, you had the head, David Kessler, who was a pediatrician, who said, I don't know anything about implants, so let's study them. Well, you know, we studied them for 14 years. They're the most studied devices in medical history. Do we really need to repeat what was already done and shown so many times? to be safe. And you know, when you get people who are out of their element and they're under pressure, strange things can happen, and it concerns me what might happen with the FDA.
All right, that's some good stuff. Let's move on to the next topic. This is on Brazilian butt lift. It says Brazilian butt lift is the most dangerous of all plastic surgeries. Mark, why don't you lead us off on this one?
Fat grafting to the buttock has been shown to have a higher incidence of life-threatening complications than other procedures. That's true, but we've also fortunately discovered what it is that makes it dangerous and how to do the procedure safely. And when you do any procedure safely, the odds change. And if people are going to continue and try and go intramuscular from an inferior approach and make other mistakes that are, you know, typical, using smaller cannulas, less than 4 millimeters or whatnot, you're going to increase the risk of having a intravascular suction of fat. It's felt to be more of a suction of the fat into the veins than it is a direct injection. But I think that everyone needs to get on board, and we need to do our job to let everyone know how to do the procedure properly to reduce these issues. And that includes our colleagues in other countries where the procedure is a lot more pervasive than it is here.
And there's been a lot of research that's being done on this, you know, a lot of society involvement, joint task force between, you know, multiple societies in the U.S. and internationally. What's your feeling on where we stand with BBL now?
Well, I think as Mark has alluded to, it is a safe procedure when done with the appropriate hands and the profound understanding of the anatomy. A lot of these places, first of all, where surgeons are doing it aren't board certified in plastic surgery. That's in our country. They do them in these what so-called chop shops. They have patients come in, the anesthesia is questionable, the surgery center and its guidelines are also questionable. And then you're having someone put in fat into areas that don't necessarily where you do not want to put them, that's intramuscularly or deep, where they can get into these veins and cause a pulmonary embolus. Some of the articles that we looked at are now coming out showing the anatomy and demonstrating if you go deep, you can get into trouble and big trouble, including fatality. So I think these joint committees are great to have. It allows discussion and allows us to, again, put our patient's safety first and disseminate the knowledge of how to do this technique safely and successfully.
Yes, you're right. And the joint multi-society task force that's been looking at that actually came out and said just that they recommended injecting only above the fascia for the reasons that you stated. So Jason, Florida's been really one of the hot spots for some of the patient deaths, certainly, and also for some of the research that's being done. So what can you tell us about BBL now?
So I think you guys have really covered the safety aspects of the procedure. So let me talk about this article from a little different perspective. One, it's in Brazil by a non-plastic surgeon operating in his house. So, I mean, I think that kind of is a big deal. The only surgery I do in my house is maybe I'll cut my dog's toenails, but, you know, maybe we'll do a little bit of filler or Botox in the house, in the kitchen. You know, I'm guilty of that. But other than that, you know, surgery belongs in an operating room, especially a case like a Brazilian butt lift. The other issue is, that's interesting, is the particular patient that they spoke about went home and then died later. So who knows what happened? It said that the patient had multiple heart attacks. Well, people can get heart attacks, you know, in post-surgery. So maybe the patient had a bad heart. Normally the deaths that occurred with these Brazilian butt lifts have been on the operating room table. So this is a little bit of a crazy story. You know, that's why when patients come to our office and they're older, you know, we get a stress test on those patients to hopefully prevent any cardiac injuries and prevent heart attacks in our operating room. So I think this particular story has a lot more safety issues than just the procedure performed.
That's some good stuff. Let's move to the last story. This is everything you ever wanted to know about vaginal rejuvenation, but were afraid to ask. You know, I know, Mark, you know, you have a lot of experience in this area.
I think the way I look at it is women who have issues with excess labial tissue are kind of like the way men were with gynecomastia 15, 20 years ago. They all think they're the only one out there who has this problem. And in my practice, we see a lot of these women. It's pretty pervasive. And, you know, for women who are young and they're healthy and they're sexually active and their lives are together, this is on their minds. This is distressing them every single day. Some women, they can't enjoy intimacy. Some are having discomfort and they really need relief and they need, you know, a good procedure that's going to restore their enjoyment of life. And I think this procedure, of every procedure I do, this procedure has the greatest impact on quality of life. No question.
Anoop, what's your take?
Yeah, I agree with Mark that this is a procedure that has sort of caught fire on social media. There's a lot of people posting it on Instagram. Maybe the plastic surgeons are doing it for sensationalism, but whatever it is, there's more and more patients and women coming to your offices to have this procedure done, or at least being inquisitive about how it could improve not only going out in a bathing suit, particularly in our state of Florida, but in terms of intercourse and giving them a higher self of self-esteem, which is kind of what we've been talking about. Plastic surgeons do a lot of that type of surgery, and I really think that vaginal rejuvenation has sort of caught fire and basically is something that's here to stay.
Jason, you got the last word on this.
I get the last word. So I'm going to talk about something that the other guys didn't talk about. So, you know, this particular article that we're referring to was a Canadian article looking at comprehensive vaginal rejuvenation. So you guys talked about the external appearance and excess labia. Well, that's part of it. The rest of the article was about what happens on the inside. And with menopause and with multiple childbirths, there can be some internal changes. With menopause, there's some dryness. The cells are changed, intercourse can be painful. So there's aspects of that. And with multiple childbirth, there can be issues with urinary incontinence and other weakening of the pelvic floor. So there's lots of devices out there that we have talked about that can potentially help this without major surgery. And actually, the article mentioned a procedure called Divatite, which is something we have in our office. It's a laser that is a hybrid fractional laser that kind of goes around inside, and it rejuvenates the epithelium of the vagina and seems to tighten things up. So the data has been pretty clear now that it seems to help with dryness from menopause, it seems to help with urinary incontinence, and there are many companies that make similar devices that have similar results.
That's great stuff, guys, and that's the 50th episode of No Spin Live. If you want to see more of that, you can see it on theplasticsurgerychannel.com.